Recorded books and one-click digital present Radioactive, how Irene Curie and Lise Meitner revolutionized science and changed the world, by Winifred Conkling. Narrated by Andrea Gallo. Chapter 1. The Most Beautiful Experiment in the World. Their moment had finally arrived. In the fall of 1933, scientists Irene and Frédéric Joliot-Curie were invited to present their latest research at the 7th Solvay Conference in Brussels, Belgium. The French researchers were thrilled to have a chance to appear before their intellectual idols, 40 of the best and brightest nuclear physicists in the world, and impress them with their insights into the structure and properties of the atom and how it worked. The Joliot-Curies were among the youngest scientists at the conference. Irene was 36 years old, and Frédéric was 33. As a research team, they'd earned a reputation for doing interesting work in the past few years, but this promised to be their breakout moment. Their chance to step out from the shadow cast by Irene's parents, Nobel Prize-winning scientists Marie and Pierre Curie. Marie had attended this conference every year, but this was the first time that Irene and Frédéric had been invited. Frédéric almost always came across as poised and confident, but when it was his turn to stand behind the podium, he was noticeably nervous. Most of the men in attendance had fashionable mustaches or beards. Frédéric's clean-shaven face made him appear even younger than he was. Irene stood by Frédéric as he presented their research findings, which suggested a new way of thinking about the architecture of the atom. Physicists at the turn of the 20th century were just beginning to understand atomic structure. We now know that atoms, the basic building blocks of matter, consist of a core called a nucleus, which is made up of particles called protons with a positive charge and neutrons with no charge, and that the nucleus is circled by electrons with a negative charge. While this information is considered elementary today, scientists were just figuring it out in the 1930s. At the time the Joliot-Curies were presenting their research, physicists thought that the nucleus of the atom consisted of protons and electrons, positive and negative particles. In the 1930s, atomic structure was uncharted territory for even the most brilliant physicists. Nobel Prize-winning physicist Wolfgang Pauli explained the state of knowledge when he said, "Physics is once again very fouled up, and for me it is so difficult that I wish I were a film comedian or something like that and had never heard of physics in the first place." The research that Irene and Frédéric presented at the Solvay conference challenged what was believed about atomic structure at that time. When the Joliot-Curies presented their findings about neutrons, the scientists in the room weren't convinced. Instead of giving the praise Irene and Frédéric had hoped for, their colleagues questioned their results. British physicist Patrick Blackett challenged the Joliot-Curie's interpretation of their research. As Irene took the floor and tried to defend their findings, the audience whispered to one another and remained dubious. Then Lise Meitner, a German scientist with an impeccable reputation, raised her hand. The room quieted. The chairman called on her, and Meitner stood and said, "My colleagues and I have done similar experiments. We have been unable to uncover a single neutron." She then sat down. Everyone in the crowd turned toward Irene and Frédéric, waiting for a response. Meitner was known for her meticulous work and brilliant experimental design. Irene and Frédéric were fairly new to the field, and no one was quite sure what to think about them yet. In recent years, The French duo had come close to making several important discoveries, but they'd also made critical mistakes in the interpretation of their results. Had that happened again? There was silence, followed by chaos, as everyone in the room began arguing at once. Irene and Frédéric stood in front of the crowd and stared at each other, embarrassed and confused. The conference director announced a break to give everyone a chance to stretch their legs and calm down. Marie Curie had attended the conference, but she was caught in a conversation, so Irene and Frédéric walked back into the gardens alone, still baffled and a little angry about what had happened. They didn't object to having their hypothesis tested in follow-up experiments, but they didn't expect the accuracy of their findings to be challenged in public. Irene and Frédéric felt confident that they hadn't made a mistake in their research, not this time. They had checked and rechecked their results. They had considered every possible explanation of their results. They didn't want to miss out on credit for this important scientific breakthrough. During the break, most of the other delegates at the conference huddled together in small groups, but didn't include Irene and Frédéric in their conversations. The message was clear. The intellectual elite sided with Meitner and assumed that the Joliot-Curies had made another mistake. Perhaps the young French couple had been working too fast, trying too hard to make a discovery before someone else stepped in and did it first. Only two of their colleagues offered any words of encouragement. The Danish physicist Niels Bohr approached them during the break and said, "What you are doing is of the greatest importance." Later, Austrian Wolfgang Pauli told them, "Congratulations, don't give up." Perhaps these men realized that if Irene and Frédéric were correct, then the nucleus of the atom was much more complex than researchers currently believed it to be. They certainly knew that physics still held mysteries and that there was a great deal they didn't yet understand. The night everything clicked. Irene and Frédéric returned to their laboratories at the Radium Institute in Paris, downhearted but determined to restore their reputations. Irene believed in their research, and although she didn't challenge Lise Meitner at the conference, Irene did intend to repeat her experiments and defend her findings. What seemed at first to be a setback proved to be an advantage. Because the Joliot-Curie's work had been so widely dismissed, none of the other researchers was interested in investigating their claims or repeating their experiments. For Irene and Frédéric, that meant that they had no competition with their research. The Joliot-Curie's repeated their experiments and got the same results. They continued their work, making small changes to their approach. On January 11, 1934, 3 months after the conference, Irene and Frédéric worked late into the evening. Irene spent her time in a chemistry lab upstairs, while Frédéric did his experiments in the physics lab in the basement. Frédéric used his favorite research instrument, the Wilson Cloud Chamber, which was named for its inventor, Scottish physicist Charles Wilson. The device allowed scientists to observe things they couldn't see with the naked eye. Frédéric had made some modifications to the device, but the basic operation was unchanged. It consisted of a glass chamber full of air that had been saturated with water or alcohol vapor. When a particle moved through the chamber, a tiny cloud formed around it and it turned into a water droplet. As it moved through the chamber, the particle would leave a misty trail, making its path, or vapor trail, visible. By watching the vapor trails in the cloud chamber, researchers could see the movement of the subatomic particles. The vapor tracks, like the contrails of airplanes in flight, only lasted a fraction of a second, so a high-speed camera was attached to the Wilson cloud chamber to photograph the droplets so their movements could be analyzed later. An infinitely tiny particle projected in this enclosed region can trace its own path, thanks to the succession of drops of condensation, Frederick said. Isn't it the most beautiful experiment in the world? In addition to the Wilson cloud chamber, the Joliot-Curies used radioactive elements in their research. Unlike the atoms of stable elements, which don't release energy, the atoms of radioactive elements are always decaying or breaking down into subatomic particles and giving off energy. By placing a sample of radioactive polonium near the Wilson cloud chamber, the Joliot-Curies could see the alpha particles that were released by the polonium. By putting stable elements between the radioactive source and the Wilson cloud chamber, they could determine if the alpha particles were blocked by the stable element, if they changed as they passed through the stable element, or if the alpha particle caused the release of a different subatomic particle, such as a neutron or a proton. Frédéric set out to perform a new experiment with a Wilson cloud chamber and a Geiger counter, a device that measures radioactivity. In their original experiment, the Joliot-Curies placed a sheet of aluminum foil between the polonium and the Wilson cloud chamber. They wondered if the speed with which the particles hit the aluminum might have an impact on the types of particles that were released, which could explain why other researchers might not have obtained the same results that they did. In his follow-up experiment, Frédéric placed the polonium next to the aluminum and used the Wilson cloud chamber to measure the particles that passed through, just as he and Irene had done in their original experiment. This time, though, he slowly moved the polonium away from the aluminum with the Geiger counter still on. He expected the speed of the rays from the polonium to grow weaker as the distance between the two elements increased, but he found something much more interesting. To his astonishment, the Geiger counter's click, 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 which reflected the presence of radioactivity, continued even when the polonium was held at a distance. Frédéric had expected the sound from the Geiger counter to fade to silence, but the clatter continued for several minutes. He didn't know how, but the aluminum was acting as if it had become radioactive. Frédéric didn't trust himself. The result didn't make sense. He repeated the experiment and heard the telltale clicking again. Had something happened to make the aluminum radioactive? Frédéric bounded up the stairs, taking them two at a time, hurrying to reach Irene's lab. He brought her back downstairs to watch the experiment without telling her what to expect. He repeated the test and again heard the sound of the Geiger counter let out its frantic clicking, gradually calming and going quiet after several minutes. Irene immediately understood the significance of the clattering Geiger counter: radioactivity. The polonium had transferred its radioactivity to the aluminum. They had created artificial radioactivity. This was a life-changing discovery, the career-defining breakthrough that Irene and Frédéric had been working for. Proving themselves. Irene and Frédéric knew what they had to do. They had 3 days to prepare a detailed report for the French Academy of Sciences' regular Monday meeting. They spent Friday and Saturday working on the project. At about 7 p.m. on Saturday, one of their colleagues was leaving the laboratory for the evening. Frédéric called him in and asked him to repeat the experiment without explaining any of the details. At that point, the Joliot-Curies needed a third party to independently confirm their findings. Their coworker repeated their experiment and achieved the same results. The Joliot-Curies had created a short-lived radioactive element, alpha particles, which are made of two protons and two neutrons bound together, are a type of radiation released during radioactive decay. The Joliot-Curies understood that during their experiment, the aluminum had absorbed alpha particles from the polonium and, for a period of about 3.5 minutes, transformed into an artificially radioactive form of phosphorus before decaying into another more stable element, silicon. The phosphorus was radioactive and unstable. The silicon was non-radioactive and stable. They knew that their claim would be unbelievable, so they needed physical and visual proof of their claim before they could announce it to the world. The short half-life meant that Irene and Frédéric had only a few minutes to work and collect the data they needed during the course of the experiment. Before they started, they laid out all of the equipment they needed and practiced the procedure to ensure that they worked accurately and efficiently. This was their chance to prove themselves, and they didn't intend to have any errors in their research. Irene had come up with an ingenious test design, one which demanded that she and Frédéric work quickly and accurately. First, Frédéric placed the aluminum near the polonium, creating a newly radioactive form of aluminum. He then put the radioactive aluminum in a vial with a stopper on top. Next, Irene added hydrochloric acid to the vial. As the acid dissolved the metal, the chemical reaction between the acid and metal produced hydrogen and radioactive phosphorus gases. Irene removed the radioactive gas from the vial, leaving inert, non-radioactive aluminum salts behind. The Geiger counter confirmed that the gas itself was radioactive, and another follow-up test proved that the gas was indeed phosphorus. When the experiment worked, Irene watched with pleasure as Frédéric jumped up and down throughout the basement of the Radium Institute. The discovery was of major importance, not only for themselves as scientists, but for the world. At the turn of the 20th century, Marie and Pierre Curie's discovery of natural radioactivity had revolutionized science and laid the foundation for the study of atomic physics. Using radioactive elements, researchers were able to conduct experiments that allowed them to develop and test theories about atomic structure that fundamentally changed their understanding of how the world worked. Now, Irene and Frédéric Joliot-Curie's discovery of artificial radioactivity was poised to change the world of physics again. Natural radioactive elements were scarce and expensive. The creation of artificial radioactive elements meant that they could be manufactured in a lab, making them much more accessible and affordable. Discovering artificial radioactivity was the first step in a nuclear science revolution. Frédéric later said, "Scientists, building up or shattering elements at will, will be able to bring about transmutations of an explosive type." While Frédéric may have imagined the exciting possibilities ahead for scientists who could change one element into another, he didn't predict that artificial radioactivity would ultimately lead to the discovery of nuclear fission and the creation of the most powerful and deadly weapon known to humanity, the atomic bomb. The demonstration. Later that weekend, Irene and Frédéric invited Marie Curie and Paul Langevin, Frédéric's mentor and a close family friend, into the lab to witness the experiment. The entire process took about half an hour. Frédéric later recalled the moment he and Irene shared their discovery with Marie, whose fingertips had been scarred and burned by years of handling radium and other radioactive elements in her own work. I will never forget the expression of intense joy which overtook her when Irene and I showed her the first artificially produced radioactive element in a little glass tube. I can still see her taking this little tube of the radio element, already quite weak, in her radium-damaged fingers. To verify what we were telling her, she brought the Geiger-Müller counter up close to it, and she could hear the numerous clicks. This was without a doubt the last great satisfaction of her life. Irene and Frédéric presented their historic report, A New Type of Radioactivity, to the French Academy that Monday, just 4 days after Frédéric's initial observation. Their report in Les Comptes Rendus de l'Académie des Sciences presented the evidence that they had created artificial radioactivity. They followed that report with a letter to the journal Nature a few days later. British physicist Ernest Rutherford wrote to congratulate the Joliot-Curies on their success, noting that he had tried similar experiments without success. Considering the catastrophe of the Solvay conference, Irene and Frédéric were overjoyed to be proven correct. They had been right. Lise Meitner had been wrong. In the experiment they presented at the Solvay conference, the Joliot-Curies had found both protons and a combination of neutrons and positrons. What they hadn't understood then, nor had anyone else at the conference, was that their experiment had triggered a two-step process. When exposed to the alpha particles from the polonium, the aluminum released a neutron and became radioactive. Then, several minutes later, and a second nuclear reaction, the radioactive aluminum released a positron and changed to stable silicon. Their data had been accurate, and now they could explain why. Meitner later sent a letter to congratulate Irene and Frédéric on their work. She wrote, "The significance of these extraordinarily beautiful results is certainly very far-reaching." Their paper on artificial radioactivity not only restored their reputations as leading researchers, but its importance put them on the shortlist as candidates for the Nobel Prize in Physics. Irene took personal pride in having created the first man-made radioactive element and being able to share the experience with her aging mother. In that moment, the scientific work and passion of two generations of the Curie family merged. Marie and Pierre Curie had discovered natural radioactivity, and their daughter and son-in-law had discovered artificial radioactivity. This proved to be one of the greatest and last moments of joy in Marie Curie's life. In the months that followed their discovery of artificial radioactivity, Irene watched her mother's health decline. By the summer of 1934, Marie Curie no longer had the strength to visit the Radium Institute. She was frail and feeble, and she suffered from a lingering fever. A specialist from Geneva assessed Marie's condition and diagnosed her with aplastic pernicious anemia, a disease of the bone marrow, with no hope of recovery. The disease was caused by exposure to high levels of radiation. Irene was a strong and stoic woman, but she was so distraught at the thought of her mother's death that she couldn't bear to stay with Marie for long periods of time. Instead, Irene's younger sister, Eve, sat by her mother's bedside. Marie Curie died on July 4, 1934. On that day, Irene lost not only her mother, but her mentor and role model. A Very Brief History of Atomic Structure. Ancient Greek philosopher Democritus, 460 to 370 BC, proposed the theory that everything in the universe is made up of tiny, indivisible, indestructible particles known as atoms. John Dalton, 1766 to 1844, suggested that atoms could combine to form compounds. He envisioned atoms as solid spheres. Joseph John Thomson, 1856 to 1940, discovered negatively charged electrons. He developed the plum pudding model of the atom, in which a large, positively charged mass, the plum pudding, contains a number of randomly dispersed negatively charged small electrons, the raisins in the pudding. A more modern model would be chocolate chips in a cookie or blueberries in a muffin. Ernest Rutherford, 1871 to 1937, changed the understanding of atomic structure in 1911. He conducted an experiment in which he fired electrons through a sheet of gold foil. Most of the electrons passed straight through, but a few were deflected or knocked out of alignment. From that, Rutherford determined that most of the mass of a gold atom was concentrated in a central nucleus, which was surrounded by electrons. Niels Bohr, 1885 to 1962, argued that electrons revolved around the nucleus in fixed orbits, much like planets rotating around the sun. His model included a nucleus made up of protons and neutrons. The modern model, sometimes called the electron cloud model, refines Bohr's model by acknowledging that it's impossible to know the exact position or speed of an electron at any one moment. Instead of fixed electron shells, this model shows electrons as inhabiting a cloud, which indicates the probable position of an electron rather than a firm boundary. This model takes into account the complex and erratic behavior of electrons. Details of the Joliot-Curie's experiment presented at the Solvay conference. In 1932, Irene and Frédéric Joliot-Curie began a series of experiments looking for positrons, a newly discovered type of subatomic particle with the mass of an electron, but a positive instead of a negative charge. In their research, they bombarded different elements with alpha particles, a type of subatomic particle emitted by radioactive elements. When they fired alpha particles at medium-weight elements, they found those elements ejected protons. When they tested lightweight elements, those elements shot out both neutrons and positrons. The Joliot-Curies wondered why the alpha particles would force out protons in some cases, but both neutrons and positrons in others. Based on their results, they theorized that protons were made up of neutrons and positrons. This was the research that they presented at the Solvay conference in 1933. They later learned that their findings were accurate, but that their explanation was not. Alpha, beta, and gamma rays. At the turn of the 20th century, scientists discovered three types of radiation, which they named alpha, beta, and gamma, after the first three letters of the Greek alphabet. We now know that an unstable radioactive nucleus tries to become stable by releasing one of three types of radiation. Alpha radiation. An alpha particle is a helium nucleus, two protons and two neutrons. They're relatively large, heavy particles. They can only travel a few inches through air before being stopped, and they cannot penetrate human skin or clothing. A piece of paper is dense enough to block them. However, alpha particles can be dangerous if ingested or inhaled in the form of radon gas. Beta radiation. A beta particle is an electron ejected by a radioactive element. They can travel about 6 inches through the air before being stopped. Beta particles can penetrate human skin to the layer where new cells are formed. Heavy clothing provides some protection. A 1-inch thick piece of wood or a sheet of aluminum foil can shield most beta radiation. Beta decay can happen in one of two ways. Either a proton breaks down into a neutron and a positive charge, or a neutron breaks down into a proton and a negative charge. Gamma radiation. A gamma ray is a short wavelength, high-energy packet of electromagnetic radiation. Unlike alpha and beta radiation, which are made of subatomic particles, gamma radiation takes the form of pure energy, so it's referred to as a ray rather than a particle. Gamma rays can travel from hundreds to thousands of feet through the air and can deeply penetrate and harm human tissue. Dense materials are needed to shield gamma radiation, such as several inches of lead or several feet of concrete. Creating artificial radioactivity. The Joliot-Curie's experiment demonstrates the process of transmutation, or one chemical element being transformed or changed into another. In this case, the aluminum is changed into radioactive phosphorus and then into silicon. Aluminum plus alpha particles changes into artificially radioactive phosphorus plus neutron. The artificially radioactive phosphorus has a half-life of 3.5 minutes, so it decays after that time into silicon. Artificially radioactive phosphorus changes into silicon plus beta radiation. The discovery of natural radioactivity. Irene and Frédéric Joliot-Curie's discovery of artificial radioactivity was a groundbreaking advancement in the world of physics. The study of naturally occurring radioactivity had begun almost 40 years before, in 1895, when German physicist Wilhelm Röntgen discovered that a luminous green glow appeared when high-voltage electric currents were passed through certain gases at low pressure. His experiment produced an invisible light that could pass through wood and books and human flesh, although it couldn't penetrate metal or denser materials. When Röntgen placed his hand in front of a screen filled with this special gas, he could see the shadows of his bones. He called the strange rays X-rays because he wasn't sure what they were. He assumed he'd give them a more appropriate name later, but the term caught on. French physicist Antoine-Henri Becquerel became interested in the phenomenon. Becquerel specialized in fluorescence and phosphorescence, things that glow in the dark when exposed to light or after having been exposed to light, and he wanted to know whether materials that exhibited these qualities might be the source of these so-called X-rays. He tested various stones and wood from his collections, but none produced X-rays. He moved on to various phosphorescent and fluorescent substances, examining each to see if it produced these invisible rays. To test an object's ability to emit X-rays, Becquerel placed the materials on photographic plates that had been wrapped in thick black paper to test whether the rays could penetrate the paper and create an image. Nothing happened until he tested uranium salts, which did emit radioactive rays. X-rays were little more than a curiosity until Marie Curie learned about Becquerel's work and decided to study it for her doctoral thesis beginning in 1897. As part of her investigation, Marie searched for other elements that might also release X-rays. She examined hundreds of metals, salts, oxides, and ores that she had borrowed from the French Museum of Natural History. She found that the mysterious rays were emitted by thorium and pitchblende, a useless byproduct of mining uranium, copper, and cobalt. Huge piles of pitchblende were in mines in Central Europe, where the minerals were used to color pottery and glass. Working with a sample of pitchblende, Marie isolated the uranium, which she knew to be radioactive. She was surprised to find that a piece of pitchblende was almost 4 times more radioactive than the pure uranium extracted from it, meaning that another, more radioactive, element must also be present. Marie set out to isolate this unknown, highly radioactive element from the pitchblende. Intrigued with Marie's research, Pierre joined his wife in the lab. Together, the Curies developed a multi-step chemical process to isolate the radioactive ingredients in pitchblende. After each step, they kept the radioactive part and threw away the waste, getting incrementally closer to a purified form of the mysterious new element. On July 18, 1898, Marie went to a nearby laboratory to ask a colleague to identify the element using a spectrograph. An electric current was run through the element and created a rainbow-like spectrum of color. Since no two elements have the same spectrum, he was able to tell Marie that she had discovered a previously unknown radioactive element. She named it polonium, in honor of her beloved homeland, Poland. 5 months later, the Curies published a report discussing the probable existence of a second new element, one even more radioactive than the polonium. They named this highly radioactive new element radium, from the Latin word for ray. It took almost 4 years of steady work, 400 tons of water, and 40 tons of corrosive chemicals to isolate 1/10 of a gram of radioactive material. On March 28, 1902, the Curies finally had enough radium to confirm that they had discovered a highly radioactive new element, one that was 1 million times more radioactive than uranium. At the dawn of the 20th century, Marie and Pierre's work on radioactivity had suggested that the atom itself was more complex than scientists had previously assumed. Before the discovery of X-rays and radioactivity, few scientists had much interest in studying atoms because they could not be seen. Radioactivity provided researchers with new tools to explore the secrets of atomic structure by studying the way elements change and respond when exposed to radiation. Although the Curies didn't realize it at the time, the discovery of radium and radioactivity was about to unlock and open the door to modern physics. Understanding radioactivity. Radioactive elements are unstable atoms that constantly give off energy in an attempt to reach a state of balance or equilibrium. Given enough time, all radioactive elements will decay into more.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.